be able to not turn the ball over, number one, and then number two, be accurate. When the play presents itself, make the big play.
Seventh career start for Case McCoy. The senior will be going tonight. Last week got in against BYU when Ash was injured. Had 12 pass attempts there. 3-3 record as a starter is McCoy. Longhorns coming off that defeat out there in Provo, Utah to BYU. So many questions to be answered with this defense. Against an Ole Miss team with young talent, continues to gain so much confidence. And here come the horns. David Ash not being in uniform, the headline of the last 24 hours. The big story earlier this week, that man, Greg Robinson, being brought back as defensive coordinator. They gave up 550 rushing yards to BYU. That's a school record that they didn't want to see ever accomplished there. So the change was made. Manny Diaz relieved of his duties. Mac Brown making the statement, poor tackling won't be tolerated.
Yeah, and so he makes the switch. And so really, what can you expect in a week? Well, you can expect more discipline. You can expect a better effort. Those are the two things that they can control. That's what Greg Robinson thinks he can control, and that's what he's going to try to control. Last week, when you watched it, you saw that people weren't necessarily out of position. They had the free hitter like you see here coming down. What you didn't see was execution. Guys getting off blocks, poor angle. I thought the safeties and linebackers did not play well at all in this game, and it wasn't just early tests. It was all game long.
Texas, he was a consensus first-team All-American and National Player of the Year. In the Olympics, he won a gold medal as a member of Team USA.
Gentlemen, this is Rodney Lowry, your umpire. My name's Matt Austin. I'm your referee. Ole Miss, you're the visiting team, so you're going to call the toss. That is heads, and that's tails. If I drop it, we'll do it again. What's your choice? Heads is the call. And it is heads. You've won the toss. You want the football. Great. Which way you guys want to kick?
Are we going to go again? Take the win.
Right. Come on over here. White over here.
There is the NBA All-Star, Kevin Durant, for the Oklahoma Thunder. Beloved here in Austin, that historic year he had back in 06 and 07. Was the National Player of the Year. Mac Brown would love to have some of that Durant fun-loving and passionate style of play come through with his Longhorns football team tonight for sure. So Ole Miss win the toss and choosing to receive. Former national title winning head coach is standing by with Kaylee Hartung. Good evening, Kaylee.
Thanks, Joe. Coach Brown, what are reasonable expectations for your defense under Greg Robinson?
Oh, that we play hard and we get in the right place and we tackle better and we force some turnovers.
How will your offensive execution be different with Case McCoy?
We probably won't be running as much option, quarterback draw. He's not that type player. What he's got to do is get the ball in the right people's hands. When he's protected the ball, he's 3-0 as a starter.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Joe.
Thank you, Kaylee. So that's the Texas side of things. As for Ole Miss, Matt, Well, since Hugh Freeze was hired, this is a team that's been headed in the right direction. They took a big leap forward with signing day this past February. Brought in one of the best recruiting classes in the country. It's a group that now that you see them, they don't look like freshmen. They don't play like freshmen.
And they're not wowed like freshmen get wowed. Yes, I got to tell you, this might be one of the best freshman classes I have ever seen. Laquon Treadwell, keep your eyes on him tonight. Big man, just 18 years old, extremely talented. Robert Kendici, raw, learning each and every week, shows up all the time. Tony Connor, a safety, my personal favorite. Great instincts. And Evan Engram, the tight end, every time you watch him, he's seemingly better with every rep.
Hugh Freeze, he led Ole Miss to a bowl win in year number one on the job. Told us yesterday, I like our focus. I think the kids are really excited for this opportunity. Just the eighth meeting all time. Texas leads the series 6-1. Last year they blew them out in Oxford. Texas won it 66-31. But this is a much different Ole Miss team now. Confident, energetic, and filled with youth that can flat out play. Nick Rose to kick away. And Jalen Walton set back deep. But Rose will boot it right up against the back wall. So it'll go for a touchback to bring out Bo Wallace, the 6'4" junior quarterback, a second year starter. The big story with Wallace is that he had shoulder surgery to his throwing shoulder back in January. Went through spring drills but didn't throw the ball and was limited early on in fall camp. But so far so good with decision making. Last year he had 17 interceptions, yet to throw a pick this season.
We had him in the opener against Vanderbilt. He had not taken a hit until game day.
Speedy Jeff Scott, he's in the backfield with him. And Scott will get the first call. And you see when he gets to the edge what he can do as he goes for a first down. The Chick-fil-A impact players, Matt.
Well, when you watch this team, you see that they have a bunch of guys who can make it. But Dante Moncrief on the outside and Laquon Treadwell are big-time playmakers. Hicks and Diggs are the two guys who may be forced into one-on-one matchups with them. It'll be interesting to see.
Wallace splits out, so an empty backfield. As Scott splits out, excuse me, and a flag comes down as he lets go of it and looked the way of Logan.
Now we talked about Laquon Treadwell, number one, just a freshman, 18 years old. He plays in the slot. Dante Moncrief on the outside test. There's a bunch of scouts here just to watch him.
Offside, defense 44, 5-yard penalty, repeat first down.
Jackson Jeffcoat getting flagged there. Matt Austin's our referee, SEC crew on the field, replay officials, Big 12 with Jack McDonald tonight. Greg Robinson flanking Mack Brown. 3 days of practice for the new defensive coordinator. First and five as they marked off the penalty. And they go once again with Jeff Scott. And Scott patiently utilizing his blockers as Ole Miss quickly into Texas territory and another first down.
Yeah, they're running into the short side of the field. A lot of times you'll see that. You may sit at home, you wonder why. It's because the safety's back. They usually roll to the field. You have one real defender to beat. That's the corner. So they attack that side.
This time it's Wallace pulling it. And successfully doing so as he gets just inside the 41-yard line. Well, it'll be second and a long two. See that green line there? That is the field goal range that the ball must get to for pregame warm-ups as to the long we saw out of Andrew Ritter, the place kicker for the Reds. And this is a quick pass to the near sideline that'll go for another first down as he's able to find Dante Moncrief.
Carrington Bynum, the corner number 23 on the top side. If they match him up against Moncrief, that's a nice matchup. But Ole Miss likes that matchup. They think Moncrief can beat anyone on this field.
Up tempo for Ole Miss as Scott was trying to keep his footing, but it was Jordan Hicks who got just enough of them.
Test, the guy who gets overlooked in this offense is Jeff Scott. And this kid can scoop. He's quicker in a hiccup. He gets on you really quick. Really does a nice job with the patience when he runs. Not a real big guy, you can see. But boy, when he's got an opportunity, he takes whatever is there.
He is a natural born playmaker. Second and eight. Complete right over the middle, and it's the freshman, Evan Ingram. And another first down for Ole Miss. 16-yard reception.
You mentioned about these freshmen and how they play. When the lights turn on, their eyes, they don't get big. This freshman class is rare. They believe they belong, as we're going to get 12 on the field.
You saw Jack Neusmer run on and then run off.
Offense number 84. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Yeah. That's the backup tight end.
Ingram lost his shoe, so he ran out. And in the interim, Hugh Freeze sent a different group of personnel in. And so the backup, he got caught.
That's the only thing that's been able to slow down this up-tempo pace on this opening drive for Ole Miss.
So if you're sitting at home and you're a Longhorn fan, you're like, what's the difference between this week and last week? What did Greg Robinson do?
Here's Wallace on the quarterback keeper again. And Wallace gets it close to the 5-yard line, a 14-yard run for the junior quarterback. Playing that option to perfection. Taysom Hill did it so well for BYU against this squad just 7 nights ago. Second and one. Here's Scott. Straight up the middle. Leg drive all the way in. Ole Miss made it look too easy.
What you're going to see is a big physical offensive line just mauling the defensive front of Texas. They have a man there, and I say man, Jared Duke, number 74, 370 pounds, and when he puts it on you, you're going backwards.
Ritter puts it through. An 8-play drive, 75 yards. It just took 2 minutes and 38 seconds. And the little guy behind the ultimate big man, 7 zip reps. Look at Lady Bird Lake here in Austin, Texas. Glad you're with us for coverage on Longhorn Network. Joe Tessitore, Matt Millen, and Kaylee Harton. Ole Miss and that offense that's been revving plenty this year. 5th in the SEC in total offense at 510 yards per game. They just tacked on 75 against this Texas defense as Jeff Scott with his second rushing touchdown of the season give the Rebs a 7-0 lead.
They were quite fond of running to their left side, and that's a big left side.
Michael Thompson back deep for the Ritter kick. And he will take a knee. Chick-fil-A impact players for the matchup with the Texas offense.
Well, it's simple with Texas. It's Case McCoy. And he's got to run this thing to perfection and let the game come to him. Don't try to get something that's not there. The guy who can really help him is Jackson Shipley. Deceptively fast. Catches everything around him. You look at the impact players on the other side, Robert Kimdichie, Tony Connor, both of them just freshmen, both of them play huge roles in this defense. They'll need their A games tonight against this Texas O.
It'll be Jonathan Gray looking to get them started. And he tried to turn the corner there. And he barely got back to the line of scrimmage as Major Applewhite is upstairs this week. Former Texas quarterback and now the offensive coordinator talked about having Case McCoy in there. He said, yeah, we lose a little bit with the quarterback run game, but he's comfortable with the quick passing game, the screen game, and he can still attack deep a bit. Here's Gray now out of the backfield. And he has stopped just about a foot ahead of the original line of scrimmage. So it'll be third and long as Tony Connor, the true freshman, came up with the tackle.
Tony Connor, we just talked about him. I'll tell you, they did a great job of getting off blocks. It's all right to be blocked. It's not all right to stay blocked. Tony Connor's really, really a good-looking young player.
Mike Davis is split to the near side, number one. That's the favorite target in a spot like this. Third and 10. The late handoff goes nowhere. Malcolm Brown was just eaten up by C.J. Johnson.
They came with a stunt, and they did not pick up C.J. Johnson coming from the outside in. And he met him full force. See him on the top side? You can watch him. He's going to come right back underneath. That's just a simple exit stunt. It was not picked up and handled by the inside, the guard. And here comes C.J. Johnson. Ooh, that's a... I'll wake you up.
Senior Anthony Farrah onto punt. He's averaging over 44 yards a boot. And Jeff Scott back at the 27-yard line to return. And it is not a good one by Farrah, as it'll be marked down at the 43-yard line. So good field position after the three and out for Ole Miss. A 35-yard punt by Farrah.
We talked about it, Tess, but on that first drive, this Ole Miss offense, they like what they have on their offensive left side. That left offensive tackle and guard are just big men. Laramie Tunsil, just a freshman, another one. They just kept on, they trusted him, and they went with him. Evan Ingram, you can see, he's number 17 on the outside. Bo Wallace, not a particularly accomplished runner, but a gritty guy.
Greg Robinson, first game as defensive coordinator. See how they get after it here on the second series. That was batted down right in the face of Bo Wallace was Reed. Cedric Reed, 6'6", and he's been playing well.
Funny, just being at practice the other day, this is all they were talking about. Talking about, look, if you're not going to get there, get your hands up. That's really J.J. Watt-esque. J.J. Watt has kind of brought a whole nother dimension of the Texans. Has brought them into all levels of football.
Second and 10, sprinting to the near side. Wallace looking over his options, goes across the grain and is able to get it to Jordan Holder for a first down. 11-yard reception by Holder.
I like the way Hugh Freeze calls games. Hugh Freeze uses all 50 yards of that football field. He makes you have to defend everything.
Barry Brunetti is coming into the game now at quarterback. He's the bigger guy at 223 pounds, and he's the run game specialist. As they go with the reverse, and they're going to pass. Treadwell looking downfield, Moncrief, and he overthrew it. So they go with the trick play, bringing Brunetti in and having Laquan Treadwell take a shot downfield.
Talking about Hugh Freeze again, that's just a perfect example. He's going to make you have to defend everything. He wants to keep a defense guessing.
Second and 10. Quick strike again. It's Holder, and he's going to be close to the sticks there. Depend on the spot. He's able to scoot ahead to the 36-yard line, and it is a first down. So a good quick strike by Bo Wallace.
Bo Wallace, where he's really taken off with his game. He reads the zone so quick, and they find the holes in the zones really quickly.
And Brunetti comes back in as he's platooning quarterbacks all of a sudden. Didn't see this earlier in the season, but they have a lot of confidence in what Brunetti can do athletically. As the officials are talking things over. I think they may want to take a look at this spot of the ball.
The previous ruling of a first down is under further review.
Remember, it was that pass play from Wallace to Holder, and he lunged ahead, looking as if he had gotten out to the 36-yard line. Interesting what we're already seeing Freeze do with the quarterbacks. Let's look and see where this ball should be spotted.
No, he's short of that.
Well, he's short of what is our yellow line, which is unofficial. As you see, his backside land right there. And at the time, the ball does not appear as though it got to the 36-yard line. Then he curled his body forward and got to the 36. So they may back this up just a bit.
Yeah, one cheek equals 2 feet.
Yeah. Your old coach.
It is. That's Coach Madden. Yeah.
Now watch his backside here hit before his upper body then goes forward. Right there is where the ball should be marked. And you see they spotted it with a good portion of the ball ahead of that hash mark, the 36. Replay official once again is Jack McDonald from the Big 12. Crew on the field is an SEC group. And this is what Hugh Freeze does best, Matt. He's all about up-tempo. Anything that involves the officials taking a moment discussing anything,
absolutely,
he doesn't like.
After review, replay shows the runner hit the ground short of the line to gain. The ball will be placed back at that spot. It'll be third down at the 37.
I think they got that right.
I believe you're right there, Mr. Tessitore.
Now, keep in mind that first drive, they ran almost exclusively behind that left offensive side. That's Laramie Tunsil, number 78, up there. Big old Jared Duke, number 74. The green line is that field goal line. They need the yellow line.
Brunetti at quarterback. Running option. And on third and one, he takes the first hit and gets an extra yard and a half. It was Steve Edman who first came up and made contact with Barry Brunetti, but it is a first down for Ole Miss.
It's a nice hit, but it's also a nice job of running. Watch how he takes the hit and with the spin and keeps it all going. But what you didn't see there, Tess, is a wrap-up on the defense. You got to come through. The hit doesn't matter. The wrap-up and the tackle, that matters.
Wallace back in at quarterback. Play action. Swings it out. And this is Ingram again. You can see how versatile Ingram can be.
And Bynum's getting a lot of work. Now he in his job there, he's got that deep third. He's got to come off of it as soon as he sees it. But Ingram is a young tight end, not very big. Runs like a receiver. They love his ability to find the holes in zones. And he has a knack for it.
Lined up tight on the near side. Jeff Scott on second and four. Look at all that room for Jeff Scott inside the 20, past the 18-yard line, and they're moving the chains yet again.
And a nice job by Jamez Logan and Laquan Treadwell of getting on the defenders to give Scott a little bit of run, a little bit of area to run into. This offense, these receivers, in order for that run game to work, they've got to block those outside guys.
Empty backfield for Wallace. Gonna take a shot. Flag is down and into the end zone is Moncrief. We will check on the flag as Moncrief just coasted in and Wallace hit him in stride.
Offside, defense 98, that penalty's declined. Touchdown.
Touchdown, Ole Miss.
You get a penalty like that, there's no excuse to keep your eyes in the backfield. Just watch the eyes. Eyes are back inside the whole time. You can't do that. It's Carrington Bynum. He's a better player than that. But when you keep your eyes inside and your responsibilities deep, it's six quick.
Going up against one of the best receivers in the SEC. Moncrief had 10 touchdown catches last year that tied a school record. This is second this year, and the Rebels offense is revving. Beautiful night here in Austin. Not so pretty on the scoreboard for the locals. Ole Miss up 14-0. There's the new defensive coordinator, Greg Robinson, brought in this week. His defense has given up 132 yards of total offense in two drives against Ole Miss. Through the years, well, Akina and Chizik back in 05 and 06. You know what happened with Chizik going on and the success he had. McDuff and Aquina in 07, the defensive coordinators. And then Will Muschamp had his run for 3 years before becoming the Florida head coach. Most recently, the young gun, Manny Diaz, up until last Sunday when he was relieved of his duties after that effort against BYU. And now Greg Robinson, former Texas defensive coordinator, back on that 04 Rose Bowl team, was the Syracuse head coach. Michigan, D.C., spent some time in the NFL, won a couple rings with the Broncos, and now side by side with Mack Brown looking for answers here against Ole Miss. Here's Thompson on the return. And he fights his way just past the 20-yard line. Of course, for the latest news on the team, you can hear it from the coach himself live at the Mack Brown press conference Monday at 11 a.m. Central, exclusively on Longhorn Network. You know, Mack obviously had to deal with some tough circumstances doing that press conference this past week. I thought he's handled everything really well, being up front, being direct, the way he's dealt with it with the players, dealt with it with the coaches and the media with the change of the defensive coordinator, Diaz out and Robinson in. Jonathan Gray going to test the left side, and he muscles his way out to the 26-yard line, tackled by Elston.
Trey Elston has the benefit of playing behind, in that particular case, Robert Kimdichie. Just watching Kimdichie, number five, you'll see him. He's the left defensive end right up here now. He was the right end. This kid's a powerful young guy. And he's got a good motor. That's the thing that sets him apart from other big players, bigger body players.
Gray again gets in the open space. Helmet came off there on the defensive player, Cody Pruitt, but a 14-yard run with purpose from Jonathan Gray.
Nicely blocked. Just dipped inside. The backer didn't step up in time, and he's able to slip through it.
They snap at 32 on the play clock. McCoy's going to take a shot downfield. But he overthrows Mike Davis, who was held up, and he gets the flag. That was Breshawn Matthews on the coverage of Mike Davis. And he's able to draw the penalty flag.
They were tussling down the field, and they got him. Double move. Just runs right past him now.
Pass interference. Defense number 13. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Breshawn Matthews.
Yeah, they're going to call that. He tried to cut him off. Mike Davis was able to get behind the secondary a week ago. He's going to get behind a lot of secondary.
Had a couple of scores against BYU. He is that stretch the field kind of guy for the Longhorns. First down at the 45 now. And here is Davis. And Davis able to make his way to the 36, a gain of 9. Once again, that green line you see, that is the field goal range for Anthony Farrah.
You see Mason Walters there in the middle of your field on the 45-yard line. He got up very slow and tried to get off. And an official's timeout for him to get off the field. Mike Davis is the guy who has big play capabilities for him down the field. And he also stretches the field for you to be able to work back underneath it. But Jackson Shipley's the guy, I believe, is the one that McCoy feels most comfortable with in terms of moving the chains.
False start, 78 offense, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
Josh Cochran, that'll back him up just beyond the 41. Or it'll be second and 6. Going back with McCoy remains Gray. Delay handoff. And once again, Jonathan Gray with a good burst up the middle and a Texas first down.
I like the play call right here by Major Applewhite. He knows he has him spread in the middle. Is very thin. Split safeties, run right down. Here goes again.
Right back to it. Up tempo, trying to take what they can get. A flag is down on the far side at the 19-yard line.
Offside, defense number 5. 5-yard penalty for the previous spot. Repeat first down.
So they will march it off. And Gray stays in on 1st and 5. Here's Case now. Tried to tuck it, run it, and was tripped up about 1.5 yards behind the line of scrimmage that time. And it was Sir'Darrius Bryant finding him.
Good coverage down the field. Don't forget, you're in the red zone now. The ball's got to come out a little bit quicker. The angles are different. You're able to get there with pressure. Just watch the pressure. And then here's the coverage. Nowhere to go with that ball.
2nd and 6. Here's Gray again. It'll be 3rd and 2. As Gray was taken down at the 15-yard line by Mike Mary.
Mike Mary's their big inside backer. He's about 245 pounds. Big man. The guy they're missing right now is Denzel Kendiche.
Sophomore linebacker, the older brother of the #1 recruit in the country. He was a freshman All-America a year ago, but injured his knee and he's out. 3rd and 2. McCoy gets it complete for a first down to Davis.
Working on the outside to Mike Hilton. That's when you have speed. When you have speed like that, Tess, they have to respect it, even with a short field behind you, because you never know if he's going to turn that thing up the field. So Hilton gives just a little bit of cushion, and Davis takes advantage of it.
First down at the 11. As McCoy checks at the line of scrimmage. Gray is upended that time by Trey Elston.
You see a safety making a play at the line of scrimmage that close, you go with play action the next play. But those safeties are screaming at that run.
Now whistle came in.
Prior to the snap, false start, 81 offense, 5-yard penalty, still 2nd down.
That was the tight end, Greg Daniels. They had 2 tights in that time. As Robert Kemdichie is off on the sideline. This is Ole Miss defense. Looks to bend but not break against the Longhorns on this good-looking, long, sustained drive. 8 plays in, over 4 minutes in. As Case McCoy continues to march him down, sets up the screen for Davis. Blockers in front as he strolls right in. Longhorns are on the board.
You had Hopkins on the outside and Espinosa the center. But that whole thing was set up as soon as they went in motion to the outside. And then here he comes back underneath. Nice block. You just follow that. Take it right in. They went with the backfield motion out of their test and it opened the middle of the field.
13-yard touchdown reception for Mike Davis. And after a week of some frustration, a little relief for Mac Brown.
Which up.
Stevie Ray Vaughan here in Austin, Texas, where the Longhorns have just gotten themselves on the board. Davis's 13-yard touchdown reception. Jonathan Gray with something on that last drive. Five carries for 43 yards. Joe Tessitore, Matt Millen, and Kaylee Hartung here on Longhorn Network. Good game between Texas and number 25, Ole Miss. As Big Boot goes through for a touchback, let's check in with Kaylee.
Joe, when this season began and Major Applewhite decided that he would be on the field to call the plays, he said it was all about wanting to be able to have a dialogue with his quarterbacks. Well, now that he's moved upstairs, it's clear who his voice on the field is. It's graduate assistant Taylor Tharp. Taylor Tharp was the quarterback at Boise State before Boise State had Kellen Moore. He has been a GA here for 2 years now, and he is in Case McCoy's ear every moment he can be. Joe.
Thank you, Kaylee. They've been stressing to Case McCoy that he doesn't have to go out and win this game. Just take care of the ball. And they said, let Mike Davis make the plays. Well, he just did. And once again, Jeff Scott, but this time hard to find some room. Actually, that was Jalen Walton. And that Texas front did a good job of pursuing that time.
That's Chris Whaley on the inside, who he did not make the tackle, but he did make the play. Santos got in on the tackle right there. But Whaley on the inside, he blew up the middle. And once you dismantle the middle, others can come and feast.
That former big, strong, physical star running back recruit turned defensive tackle. Second and 11 now. As Walton remains the back with Bo Wallace. Wallace with time, and he goes underneath to Moncrief, and Moncrief is forced out that time by Duke Thomas.
He ran backwards, Steph. You got to gain ground. Sets up this third down.
Seeing a little pep in the step of that Texas defense now.
And if you're a Texas defender and your name is Jackson Jeffcoat, now you're playing against a freshman. Listen to your sideline and crank it up a little bit.
Third and 9. Here's Wallace sprinting. Flag is down as it goes incomplete. He was looking Logan's way. It looked like there was some motion.
Prior to the snap, false start. Number one offense. 5-yard penalty. Repeat third down.
That's the freshman receiver Treadwell,
who has been quiet. It's just the first quarter, obviously. But Treadwell's a guy who presents problems with his size and his speed and his ability to use his body. He's a big man.
He was the SEC Freshman of the Week in that game against Vanderbilt when he had 9 catches. Third and 14. Wallace. That was batted down by Malcolm Brown.
That rhyme test.
I get paid sometimes, Matt. We try.
Batted down by Malcolm Brown. Again, this is what we were talking about. They practice this all week long. If you're not going to get there, get your hands up. Make the ball at least come out high, and if not, you'll get it knocked down.
So Campbell on the punt away to Diggs. Oh man! Ball came loose as Diggs was blasted, and a flag is down. I believe that was Collins coming down on special teams. I mean, he was shot off like a missile.
You can come from the side, but you can't come from the front. And Collins clearly came from the front where he could be seen.
Kick catch interference on the kicking team. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
Such a dangerous play with Collins coming in full speed on Quandre Diggs. Look at this in real time. Ah! 15-yarder. This is Texas ball when we come back. Moments ago, we saw the special teams play senior defender DeHendrick Collins for Ole Miss as he came crashing in on Diggs.
Now, Tess, there was a good argument to be made. You can see right at the end here, Eccles, number 15. He pushes him into him. And that's what Hugh Freeze was trying to argue, but it was a moot point.
It's a good field position for Texas, but tackled for loss that time. And once again, it's C.J. Johnson getting to Malcolm Brown. C.J. Johnson is a guy that suffered a broken leg in spring ball. He's a little slow to recover. A man, oh man, has he been coming on. Second and 11. Here's McCoy now looking to extend the play, and can he turn it upfield? Here goes McCoy, and he fights his way for a first down. Could have slid, but instead he ducked to the inside and got to the 35 to move the chains. A 12-yard run by Case McCoy.
Nicely done by Hawkins on the end. Watch, come back inside, and then he just pins Kim Dichie. He's off to the races.
Brown remains in as the back flanking Case McCoy here. Going to try to set up the quick screen. And out just beyond the 30-yard line is Kendall Sanders.
Sanders picks up a quick six. You're in second and four. That's all you want. It's very, very manageable. You have both aspects of your game calling in. This is an easy rundown, play action, or throw.
Second and four for McCoy. Not to confuse you with that green line, but that's the field goal range for Anthony Farrah. They're already within. Here's Davis now utilizing the blocker, but then wrapped up and taken down by Golson. So Golson comes up with the good individual play, and that'll leave them about 2 yards short. It'll be third and two.
That's a heck of a play by Golson. He got off the block and still made the tackle and forces a third down.
Clock counting down here in the first quarter. So entertaining it was, with Ole Miss jumping out in front in quick order. Their first two drives, they looked like they were going to roll. But all the horns started to hook them. 14-7 game, end to one.
When it's game day, I'm ready.
You're watching.
SRV, one of the all-time greats, who was elected into the Blues Hall of Fame 13 years ago on a beautiful night here in Austin, 87 degrees. Case McCoy is 6 for 6 for 35 yards for the Texas Longhorns, who have gained some momentum as we start the second quarter with a third down and two. Joe Bergeron in the I formation, the tailback. And Bergeron with one little shift to the right and a duck ahead with those 230 pounds and a first down for Texas.
And you also, I think, Josh Cochran is getting up very slow.
3-year starter, the right tackle.
Holding that left arm like it's a shoulder.
Very athletic guy for his 6'6" frame. Came in as a freshman and started right away. He was thrown into action back then due to injuries, and he has been able to maintain that starting role for Mac Brown. So Cochran comes out. Bergeron remains in the backfield with McCoy on first down. Sanders able to keep his footing. Good balance that time.
Tess, here's the difference between this game now as they go to the hurry up and a week ago as they pick up the first down. McCoy is just taking what the defense has given him. A lot more patient, not trying to push the thing down the field. This is what they needed to do a week ago.
Offense seems more manageable as Bergeron was tied up by Tony Connor. But look at the balance by Sanders.
And a nice job by Jackson Shipley to clear that whole thing. And then look at the nice balance, gets the hand down, knows where the first down marker is. Got the first, and of course now is second and 10.
Davis to the top of your screen, Jackson Shipley to the bottom on second and 10 with Bergeron as the lone back. Going to test the left side, but he was met that time by D.T. Shackelford. This is a guy on Shackelford who missed the past couple of years with an ACL.
Yeah, and he had the knees, but he persevered. And I'll tell you, we watched him in the opener, and he contributes. He wears the brace, which he should. But he's a good football player. He's got really good instincts.
Third down and 8. Need to get inside that 4-yard line for a first down. McCoy to the end zone. Davis went up for it, but it was a little too long, a little too far, as he was covered by Mike Hilton.
That was good defense by Hilton. He had him right from the start, gave him a cushion. They were going to try to get on top of him. He used the sideline as an extra defender. You have to stay in bounds, and then you just kind of force him to the side. You saw the official's hat come off. That means he went out of bounds.
That's not a good sign right there. Mike Davis limping off as Anthony Farrah comes on for the 28-yard attempt, his first field goal attempt of the season. And you see Farrah with that smooth, confident, golf swing-like technique as Texas pulls to within 4. Now Mike Davis coming off the field. That's a concern. Great weapon for the Horns. Case McCoy's getting his 7th start of his career, because last week this is what happened to David Ash, suffering shoulder and head injuries midway through the 4th quarter in that loss to BYU. He was injured and left the game. He's not dressed. He's not here. Earlier in that game last week at BYU, DeJay Johnson, really the X factor for the Texas offense, blazing fast, use him at receiver and in the backfield. He hurt his ankle and he was lost for the game and also out for tonight's action against Ole Miss. And now moments ago we saw Mike Davis limping off the field. Ace McCoy 7 of 8 for 45 yards and a touchdown pass for the Texas offense as they got the field goal moments ago and cut into that Ole Miss lead. David Ash and DeJay Johnson, you see the production that's not here for Texas tonight. But without Ash, it gives the offense a much different feel, a much different look as to what they can do and what they will do. But so far, not a bad thing in terms of just making a more manageable night for the Texas offense with McCoy.
I think it's a completely different game. The way they're calling the game is completely different. You're seeing a patient Case McCoy tonight, and you're seeing a quarterback who's being asked to take what the defense has given him, and right now he's been masterful.
Here's Jeff Scott for Ole Miss. And you see the speed that Scott has as he was able to get just to the outside of Adrian Phillips. As Scott goes for nearly 7 yards there, it'll be 2nd and 3.
Adrian Phillips, one of the safeties last week, did not have a very good game.
Scott again, yet to be touched until he got out to the 45-yard line and just beyond, where Thompson finally got to him. 13-yard run by Jeff Scott.
Evan Ingram, number 17, the freshman tight end. That was completely on him. That was a great block to allow him to get that edge. See this matchup down here in the left tackle, and that's Laramie Tunsil.
Laramie Tunsil, one of the biggest recruits in the country, the true freshman starting tonight. They stay with Scott on the ground, and why not? Another first down for the Reds.
Test. Laquon Treadwell blocked his guy in the slot 15 yards down the field. Not to be outdone, Dante Moncrief did the exact same thing. You can hear, there's Ingram inside. Look at that block by one, and then 12, Moncrief. That's 15 yards down the field. When you get blocking like that.
Here's Walton now. I mean, these receivers for Ole Miss, Matt, 6'3", 215 is Treadwell. 6'3", 226 is Moncrief. These are big guys opening up holes for small, fast running backs.
And fast. And they love the game. Hey, all you have to do to measure a guy on the outside is if he blocks, Tess. And these guys are blocking.
Second and eight now.
Now, if you're a Texas defender, you've got to get off those blocks. You got to have a little violence in your hands. Get rid of that block and get it on the play.
Reminder, that green line is the field goal range for Andrew Ritter, the kicker for Ole Miss, as that's incomplete. So they are already within the range, going to the left in pregame warmups. Ritter was able to hit from 57 yards. So that's that green line that you see on the field.
Okay, third down right now. This is the down that the Longhorns have to win.
Third down and eight. Wallace quickly gets rid of it, and quickly coming up is Phillips.
Nicely done by Phillips.
Evan Ingram had no chance.
He closed the gap. Closed the gap and took an excellent angle and was able to make that tackle. They struggled with their safeties a week ago. And Phillips, that's called redemption. They're going to go for it here on fourth down, Tess.
Fourth down and four. Hugh Freeze's offense stays out there.
You got a single on the top side. With Moncrief, safety sitting in high.
Play clock under five, and they're going to use a timeout. Fourth and four. Will Hugh Freeze be rolling the dice when we come back?
This is football on the Longhorn Network. It's brought to you by Alamo Draft House Cinema, now located in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. For showtimes, go to drafthouse.com/DFW.
Shouldn't every stadium have a 2,000-pound steer hanging out in the southwest corner? Bevo looking good tonight. It is fourth down and four.
Bevo looked uncomfortable the way he was sitting there. That would hurt my front paws.
He's plenty fine, trust me. Let's see if this Texas defense can be plenty fine here against the Rebels.
Look at the top of your screen up top. You got Bindham one-on-one with the safety sitting inside. Let's see if they go to the same thing.
See if Wallace can flag that here. Fourth down and four. He's looking that way, and it was batted again. Third time that's happened tonight. Cedric Reed getting in on a big fourth down play.
Tess, they saw the same thing we saw from up here. And I got news for you. Carrington was going to be beat. Moncrief had him. But because Reed got his hands up and knocks that thing down, that prevents it. Moncrief, you have to respect his speed, and there it is. That ball would have been right on the money.
They're having a nice little conversation as is the turnover on downs, and the Texas offense will be right back out there as Mack Brown, I think he's enjoying to see some fiery play here in this second quarter from his defense. Here's Shipley now. Jackson Shipley with a big move out past midfield, and just like that, Texas is in business. That was a missed tackle by Chief Brown, number eight.
Chief Brown, you're going to watch him. The right angle, he just got a little too high. See that right there? Shipley took advantage of it. You got to use the sideline as your other defender, and you got to come into that inside shoulder. He got up a little bit too high. Shipley took advantage.
Jonathan Gray now able to get off that left edge, and Gray muscles his way to the 36. Check in with Kaylee.
Good
We see Mike Davis back out on the field. He tweaked his right ankle in that last offensive series. They taped up both ankles for good measure, Joe.
Here's McCoy on second and two, Kaylee, and he slides for a first down. So that's good news. The update on Mike Davis, already with DeJay Johnson out last week. Can't afford to have their big play guy missing.
I really like the game right now that Case McCoy is playing. He's a tough sucker. He's competitive.
Here's Davis. Tiptoeing the sidelines, Mike Davis, and they're going to say he was out at the 25.
Still limping just a tad.
As long as he can perform.
But I'll tell you what he did. Did a nice job of following Jackson Shipley's block. These slot receivers on both sides of the ball, they're really blocking well tonight. So if you're a defender, man, you got to come down. You got to get your hands down. You have to disengage.
6-yard reception by Davis, second and four. Swaim and McFarland, two tight ends now for Texas here with Gray as the back. And Gray will have the first down for the Longhorns.
This offensive line, they're winning the battle up front. They're getting push. The line of scrimmage is moving towards the defensive side. Something you didn't see a week ago. I tell you, Mac has to be happy with the way his team has responded, especially after coming out and going down by 14.
Showing a little resolve here. Gray again. And it'll be first and goal, Texas. Up tempo, has him to the line already. Can Gray get to the corner? Yes. Texas takes the lead.
Watch this dip inside, and because of that, you see Lewis, 24, takes a shot, and what that did was it made the corner a little shorter, and Gray was able to take advantage of it.
...17 unanswered for Mack Brown's team, and they did it with attitude. Jonathan Gray, 75 yards already, and this touchdown. Horns on top.
Say thanks to me like a cowboy. I do tricks for you like a cowboy shoes.
The decision that Coach Brown had to make, you know, if we would have played better, Coach Brown wouldn't have been in that type of position.
I think anybody can question this is a good football team. We need to show that on Saturdays.
Just continue to have effort, and that kind of fixes all those other mistakes.
This team is going to be a player-led team, so no matter who the coach is coming in, we'll, as leaders, we'll get this thing corrected.
Those were the players earlier this week with news that Manny Diaz was relieved of his duties as defensive coordinator, and Greg Robinson would be stepping in here at Texas. And the defense in the second quarter responding. They had the fourth down stop against Ole Miss, and then the offense coming right down the field to take a 17-14 lead. Glad you're with us. Joe Tessitore, Matt Millen, Kaylee Hartung with you here in Austin, Texas, up by three. Jalen Walton takes a knee. Ole Miss came out firing, Matt, and then Texas settled in a bit.
Texas settled in, and what they really relied on, that last bite that you heard from Jackson Jeffcoat, that's, to me, that's the whole key. It doesn't make a bit of difference what your coaches say. They give you the plan, and then you have to execute it. And they're not out there on the field with you. It's on you as a player to get the job done. And if you don't, it's on you.
option now as he pitches to Walton. And Walton wasn't touched until he was 7 yards downfield. There is a flag down, as that was Sherrod Evans coming up defensively for Texas. Matt Austin, our referee from the SEC.
Holding, offense 85. 10-yard penalty from the end of the run. Repeat first down.
They're going to get Jamez Logan, the wide receiver.
See, right out here on the outside, they're going to call that. Actually, that doesn't look too bad on Sherrod Evans. That Breeze can feel it kind of slipping right here. This offense is going to have to take back what it had and what it's lost.
It's a spot of foul penalty. So it backs it up to a first and 11. Wallace. Ball came loose
that
there.
A fumble.
And it looks like Texas has it. I think Jackson Jeffcoat is sitting on it, and he is. That is a turnover in prime real estate for the Longhorns.
That ball just popped out of his hand. Some days the football gods are with you, and some days they're not.
That was like something out of a cartoon. He went to throw it, and the ball wasn't with him.
Jeffcoat came around. They were opportunistic. That's what it is. That thing, he'll do that for another 12 games and not have it happen.
Fumble recovery by the senior Jackson Jeffcoat. And Texas will set up shop just inside the 18-yard line. And they're going to use a timeout.
Texas, their first time out of the half. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
Case McCoy ready to talk things over there. So momentum is all with the Longhorns.
Well, Tess, so you wanted to know what kind of a difference can a new defensive coordinator make? And there's your answer. And even if it's just a little bit of enthusiasm, if it's a little bit of grit, if it's a little bit more a kick in the rear, whatever it is, it's surfacing a little bit tonight. You knew they were going to play better because you couldn't play as bad as they did a week ago.
You know, Mac Brown said, boy, the kids feel awful about what happened. He said, you know, there's a solution to that. Tackle.
Yeah.
Go out there and play with some fire, play with some purpose. And they have done that here in the second quarter. And then good things can happen for you when you put forth that kind of effort. And they just did. The fumble recovery by Jeffcoat. And now first down just inside the 18 for Texas. Here's Malcolm Brown, as he's going to test the middle just for a couple of yards. Let's check in with Kaylee.
Joe, this will be the second offensive series for Texas where they will be without two starting members of their O-line. Right guard Mason Walters has tweaked his left hip, and right tackle Josh Cochran his left shoulder. He's been taken into the training room for further evaluation.
All right, so some changes up front for Texas. Second and 8 as Brown remains the lone back with McCoy looking to pass. Lofts it to the end zone. And a flag comes in as Davis had Mike Hilton going up with him. And once again, Davis drawn that flag on the coverage from Hilton.
The mistake Hilton makes at the end is get your head turned back. You saw the ball. He was in great position. Didn't have to push him. All you do is flip his head around.
Defense 28. By rule, the ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
He got those hands right in the chest of Mike Davis. You know, Bo Wallace is looking to see his defense come up with a stop after that error he had moments ago. So it'll be first and goal at the 2.
I like the game that Case McCoy's playing here right now.
See the penalties tonight for Ole Miss.
Center moved.
Nice. Dom Espinosa.
Full start, 55 offense, 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Now back him up to the 7-yard line.
Now it's time for one of these Ole Miss defenders to make a play. The guy's been quiet tonight. Has been Robert Kimdichie. Kimdichie, the talented young freshman, but raw. Right now, he needs that raw to turn into roar.
I don't know that we've said his name once on a defensive play yet. Jonathan Gray, and he is stopped right away at the line of scrimmage. As that time, Kimdichie and company were in there. There was motion, though.
5-yard penalty.
Back-to-back penalties, as that was motion against Swain, the tight end. So Texas, all of a sudden, after the pass interference, is going in the wrong direction. Four false starts tonight for the Longhorns.
You get a one-on-one down here. Whole field. And he was going.
Another whistle.
Timeout.
It was a timeout call.
Timeout
by Ole Miss.
Their second timeout of the half.
They'll have one remaining. As Case McCoy looks to cash in here. Of course, McCoy starting in place of David Ash, who was unable to practice this week with the shoulder and head injuries. He's a no-go, not even dressed. According to our reporters, not even here in the stadium tonight. But McCoy's been managing things well, just that one lone incompletion.
Yes, I think he's playing great. And I think Major Applewhite upstairs, I don't know if being upstairs has made a difference, but a marked difference in how he's calling the game as opposed to a week ago. Now, certainly it's a different team and all those, you know, there's a bunch of different factors. But having said that, he's taking exactly what Ole Miss is giving him. And if you're going to play deep, they're going to throw it underneath. And if you're playing it tight or you have a single high safety or a safety to the middle field, he takes a shot to the outside. I like the game he's calling right now, and I love the way his team's responded.
There's the former Texas quarterback, Major Applewhite. Of course, Brian Harsin took the head coaching job at Arkansas State. He was the co-OC and now has the job, moved up top tonight. Here's first and goal, and Brown had no chance. I thought we just said we haven't mentioned Robert Kimdichie. We'll mention him now.
It's funny how that works. Yeah, Kimdichie. He took a hard inside move, was never touched.
Number one recruit in the country and a guy who can play anywhere along the defensive line. A tackle for loss is 6 yards. Second and goal. They set up the screen. And that goes incomplete as Sir'Darrius Bryant was in there fairly fast.
Fairly fast. You're telling me he almost had a pick on that thing.
He did.
He drew a bead on that. That must have been, he must have had him in man coverage. Because he saw it right away, ran right past everything. And it's going to set up this big third down.
Remember, they had first and goal at the 2-yard line, and now it's third and goal from the 18. They go conservative with Brown.
That's a win for the Ole Miss defense.
It sure is. The pass interference had them knocking on the door at first and goal from the 2. A couple of penalties, the tackle for loss, and instead they will send Anthony Farrah on to attempt the field goal.
You see that Bo Wallace? That was an angry warm-up. You could see the way he was throwing. He's a little tick.
Farrah made his first attempt of the year earlier tonight from 28. This from 30. Transfer from Penn State gives them a 6-point lead here on a beautiful night in Austin, not far away from the Driscoll Hotel downtown. 20-14, Texas on top. Texas has roared back. Ole Miss jumped out 14-0 early on, and then it's been all Longhorns. And coming up at the half, it'll be Texas game day halftime report. The Los Dodds, the AD of Texas, will join Lowell Galindo. We'll check in with Ricky Williams, Ahmad Brooks, and David Green. Gentlemen, we do see you indeed. Can't wait to hear what the guys have to say at the half. As Jalen Walton will be back deep to return Nick Rose's kick. Bo Wallace probably feeling like he dodged a bullet. Quarterback for Ole Miss with a fumble moments ago. Texas was right there on the doorstep, but only came away with three. Here is Walton. And Walton keeps his footing, but only can get to the 20-yard line. Kaylee.
Joe, I've got a guy who doesn't need an introduction in these parts, Kevin Durant. Kevin, what have you been up to in the offseason?
Well, just working on my game and, you know, trying to get better for the next season.
Congratulations are in order. We hear you've gotten engaged. Is our invite coming in the mail?
No doubt. It's there for you.
We appreciate that. What is it like being a Texas fan in Oklahoma?
Well, it's different. You know, I play for an Oklahoma team, so they cut me some slack, but I let them know about Texas all the time.
I bet you do. Thank you so much, Kevin. Joe?
Here's Scott on first down. A little hop and then nothing doing, taken down right at the line of scrimmage by Adrian Phillips. Kevin Durant, nice to visit with him. I'll tell you, not just a great player, and you hear him talking about working in the offseason, but his charitable efforts and his commitment to the relief efforts of what happened with the tornado victims. Such an admirable young man doing the right thing in the course of the past year. Second and 10 now. As Wallace looking over his options, getting a little pressure, and just had to throw it away as Shiro Davis was coming down hard on him. Cedric Reed was the first to get after Bo Wallace, and then he got rid of it.
Well, the bigger thing is there's no place to throw it down the field. Then here comes the pressure from Reed, and he has to throw it away. But big third down here, it's on these receivers to get their separation.
One of three tonight on third down. Those first couple of drives, they were motoring on first and second down. They didn't get to spots like this, third and 10. Pressure again. And Wallace unable to convert. And once again, Greg Robinson's defense fired up here in this second quarter.
Well, he should be fired up about his secondary, because they are not getting anything. He tries a little bit of double move, bind them all over the top of them. You look on the other side, Treadwell, Jamez, Logan, no place to throw the football. You want that quarterback to try to beat you with his legs.
Campbell kicks away. And he drives it far, takes a bounce inside the five and all the way into the end zone. 75-yard boot by Campbell.
Yes, I think of all the players tonight who had to play big, there's one guy who came through, and that's been Case McCoy. Case McCoy has done exactly what they've wanted him to do. He's been spot on with his throws. He knows where to go with the ball. He's managed the game well. He's taking shots down the field when he's had to. He's recognizing things. And oh yeah, by the way, not the fleetest of foot, but he's able to get the yardage when it's there. I think he's just played outstanding tonight.
Came in with a great attitude to fall camp, backing up David Ash, who's out tonight with the shoulder and head injuries. And here is McCoy looking to pick up a block on the edge, but he was tracked down that time. As it was Cameron Wiggum who was able to get to McCoy. 3 yards gained on the ground by the senior. Second and 7, coming up on 4.5 minutes here in the first half. Jonathan Gray. And Gray goes ahead for about a gain of 3 as he is taken down by the freshman Tony Connor, the true freshman who was the big recruit they beat Alabama for. His very first play in college football, an interception in primetime on national TV against Vanderbilt.
And he hasn't slowed down since. I tell you, Tess, he has what you can't teach, and that's great instincts.
Third and 4, Texas 2 of 5 tonight on third downs. Out of the backfield is Gray to move the chains.
Smart. That's just smart by McCoy. Yeah, let him get let the receivers clear some things out and then just dump it back down underneath.
Ole Miss defensive player is being tended to by the medical staff, and that's C.J. Johnson, one of their premier guys up front, who's been so active already tonight. Remember, he had the broken fibula this past year. Took him a good week into camp before he could really compete. Was dealing with a bad limp throughout most of camp. And led the team with 6.5 sacks last year.
Watch him down here. You see him right there, number 10.
And Johnson now jogging off the field. So that's a good sign for Ole Miss. First down for Texas at the 33-yard line. Case McCoy, 10 of 12 tonight. Robert Kimdichi on the sideline for the moment. Joe Bergeron with a hole, ran into his own man and then regained his footing for a 9-yard run.
Texas offensive line is playing like we haven't seen them play. Yes. They are coming off the ball and they are staying on their blocks.
Second and one, quick to get to the line. Zappa White, the philosophy this year of Mack Brown is to be up tempo. And this time Bergeron is able to get 3 yards and a first down. So that'll temporarily stop the clock. He was tackled by Shackelford and they'll move the chains again. Not as explosive of an offense as we saw the first couple games with Texas, but a well-managed offense that's getting the job done.
I think it's smart. I think what they're doing is just good, smart football.
Play action. McCoy has time over the middle and gets it complete to Sanders. And Kendall Sanders, as you see him crossing that green line on the field, that's the line delineating field goal range for Texas, and Anthony Farrah, who going to his right was good from 52 yards earlier.
We're picking on Hilton here all night tonight.
First down run now. Gray to the 28-yard line. Texas moving well here.
And they're trying to go with a hurry up. And Ole Miss is rolling a safety down. They're single high up top, so they're getting that safety down inside to help in the run game, but it hasn't been helping.
Gray taken down in the backfield. And that was C.J. Johnson, who moments ago was jogging off the field. And now he comes up with a big play.
You're going to watch him on the left side of your screen. See, he took that inside, hard inside move. They had a little stunt going on the outside. Him inside, backer to the top side. They were also sitting in too deep. And so you're going to want to try to run at that thing. And this third and 10, let's see what they draw up.
Minute 10 remaining in the first half. Texas with 2 timeouts facing a third and 10 here. As you see Mack Brown talking things over, they will most likely be using a timeout here with a second left on the play clock, and that's what they do, leaving 58
timeout
ticks of the clock left here in the first half. Texas up 20-14.
30-second timeout.
Case McCoy in tonight for David Ash. The comparison of quarterbacks, Wallace and that Ole Miss offense, started red hot. McCoy's been taking what's given to him. 11 of 13 on the night, had the touchdown pass to Davis.
And Bo Wallace, on the other hand, early on seemingly had a lot of room to throw, But as this game's gone on, this coverage has tightened up a lot. Bo Wallace has had nowhere to go with the ball.
There's an all-time great Rocket in these parts. The Rocket, Roger Clemens, the seven-time Cy Young Award winner. Texas great back in the early 80s. Here's the hurler of choice tonight. Case McCoy, third and 10 Longhorns. One timeout remaining. They keep it on the ground on third and 10, and Gray just gets inside the 31-yard line.
I don't know if I like that one, Tess. So now you've got fourth, and you're looking at, a 47-yard field goal?
Well, within the range of the strong leg, Anthony Farrah.
Final timeout of the half. Be a 30-second timeout.
Farrah's one of the kids who was able to transfer and eligible to play immediately after the NCAA sanctions at Penn State. When it was at Penn State, he hit a 46-yarder. His career-long here with Texas is 42, and the ball just resting outside the 30, so this will be a 47-yard attempt.
I talked to him before he came down with the transfer. He's a Texas kid.
Right.
And he loved kicking where he was up at Penn State, but he wanted to be closer to home, to be closer to his parents, which I think his mom was having some physical ailments.
He's 2 for 2 on the night. Made from 28 and 30, this from 47. And that's the leg talent of Anthony Farrah. So they may have been conservative on that third and long, but steady and reliable was Farrah. Three field goals tonight. Boy, a change in attitude for the Texas Longhorns. You know, their former offensive lineman, Casey Studdard, gave them a talking to this week.
I don't care if you win or lose, but if you're out there beating these other cats down, we'll be happy about that. But if you go out there and play soft football and you get beat, that's really what hurts us. Because we felt like when we came in here, we came out in the field, and we stepped through those gates, come through the smoke, it was like, it's on. Y'all gonna have a fight for 60 minutes.
What he said right there, Tess, at the end of that, that's the whole game. You gotta make it personal. And if you have to turn it into your own personal battle for 60 minutes, that's what you do. And you cannot lose the battle. You go in, you start, you do not quit. And if you have enough of those guys, you'll have a great game.
They needed to be told to simply fight. And that's what they have done here after trailing by 14 early. 23 unanswered points for Texas. Caleb Moore now from the four. And Moore gets it out past the 25, out to the 27-yard line with just over half a minute remaining. Boy, Ole Miss tonight, they came out and everything was going their way. And then all of a sudden that Texas defense manned up and Ole Miss's offense has sputtered a bit.
And they can't seem to get that rhythm back. Remember, initially, their offensive line was controlling the line of scrimmage. You're not seeing that right now. But the biggest piece of the puzzle for me is this Texas secondary. They have taken these receivers out of the game.
No timeouts remaining for Ole Miss as Mathers takes the carry here.
You listen to Casey Studdard with that talk, and it reminds me of his dad. Boy, the apple didn't fall too far from the tree. Old Dave Studdard played for the Broncos for a long time and had that same attitude.
Bo Wallace downfield. That'll stop the clock with the first down to Jordan Holder.
That's going to be
targeting. And there's going to be a penalty coming in here. We'll see if they call this targeting. That was Adrian Phillips coming in.
Lowered his head, helmet to helmet.
Remember, two forms here, either targeting going to the neck or head area or the crown of the helmet. And obviously, you can see the contact to the head. That's why the helmet came off.
Personal foul, targeting number 17, defense, targeting a defensive player above the shoulder. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Now test,
number 17,
right?
Is disqualified.
Yeah, see, now
that is the other side of this. The rule's been in since 2008, but he's ejected from the game, Matt.
Yeah, but they can go right now and use the replay, and they can overturn him getting ejected.
Now, listen, the 15 yards is still going to stand.
The ruling of a disqualification is under further review.
All they're reviewing here, folks, is the ball is now on the 35-yard line, which already, with 9 seconds remaining, is a 52-yard field goal attempt for Andrew Ritter, who going to this end hit from 57 in pregame. Here's what you need to know. As of now, Adrian Phillips is out of the game. That's the new punitive side to the targeting rule. All they're doing on the replay is not whether or not the 15-yard penalty stands, but taking a look and saying, is he going to stay in the game or not? Was it targeting? Where was the contact here? This is the targeting to the head or neck area of a defenseless opponent. It could be with the helmet, the forearm, the elbow, the shoulder. It doesn't matter. It's not helmet to helmet. It's hitting the defenseless player from the head and neck up.
That's a tough one because the receiver, he's ducking, and the defender is trying to make the hit but not trying to blow him up.
Once again, the penalty still stands. What they're reviewing here is that the ejection, can that
after
be overturned?
Review, 17 will not be disqualified.
I think that's
however,
a good call.
Rule, the 15-yard penalty will still be enforced. Automatic first down.
So Adrian Phillips will stay in the game. But the 15-yarder is still put forth. So 9 seconds left and the ball on the 35-yard line. What looked like a possession with 33 seconds remaining where Ole Miss was contented with no timeouts to run out the clock. Now an opportunity. Wallace pressured. And he was chased down by Jackson Jeffcoat.
Nicely done by Jeffcoat, just staying on his horse, never giving up. Working on Tunsil, you're going to get around the top side. That's time enough to throw, but he didn't quit on the play.
Andrew Ritter is coming on the field for Ole Miss to attempt the field goal. And this will be a 52-yard attempt. His career long's only 37. He missed from 55 and 44 week one at Vandy. 1 second left, 52-yard attempt for Ritter. Remember, he was comfortable from 57 in warm-ups to this goalpost. And he's able to sneak it through. How about that? Andrew Ritter with a 52-yard field goal with double zeros on the clock to bring us to the half. So the targeting penalty puts them in field goal range, and Ritter connects from 52. Kaylee.
Coach Brown, what did you say to your team? You were down 0-14 that then sparked this 23-point run until that last field goal.
Just keep playing. It's going to be a long night. Last week I was disappointed when we got up. We had some adversity and we didn't play as hard. Tonight we got to keep playing regardless of what happens. There's going to be good plays and bad plays.
How do you assess what Case McCoy has been able to do with your offense?
Case has done exactly what we wanted him to do. The offensive line's playing well. We're blocking people up front and he's managing the game very well, getting it to the right people.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Joe.
Thanks, Kaylee. Boy, that was a wildly entertaining first half here in Austin. 23-17. Texas. And number 25, Ole Miss, Case McCoy, 11 of 13, 104 yards in that first half. KD getting in with Smokey the Cannon. Lowell and Texas Game Day halftime report after this short break. Stay with us. What a fun night in Austin. Bo Wallace and number 25 Ole Miss have come to town, and Texas got the best of them with Case McCoy filling in for David Ash at quarterback. 23-17. Texas scored on each of their last five possessions after Ole Miss jumped out 14-0. They settled in fine, did the Longhorns. Joe Tessitore and Matt Millen with you here on Longhorn Network. The storyline all week long was defense. New defensive coordinator comes in. Early on, looked like things may go south, but then the defense started playing the way you'd expect them to if they wanted to have some purpose and passion.
Yeah, and where it really showed up really was in the secondary, because this is a good receiving core from Ole Miss. And because of that secondary play, it started to lend itself to the front. And the defensive front then can get after the quarterback a little bit more. And it really, I'll tell you where it shows up. Defense test is all about want to and pursuit. And look at this. Look at all the orange jerseys flowing. And then, again, this is Jackson Jeffcoat at the end of the half. And he's able to do this because the coverage down the field dictates that ball can't be thrown. And why? Now, this is a kid, Phillips, just a week ago, who struggled in this game. But I want you to watch his feet on contact and drive through the ball. And because of that, you're getting sure tackles, you're getting great pursuit, and you're getting much better defense.
See the total yards comparable, 220 for Texas, 207 for Ole Miss. The one turnover, Ole Miss fumbled, but Texas was only able to get three out of it. Keep in mind, we had that targeting penalty just before the half, and it gave 15 yards to Ole Miss, which lined them up for a successful 52-yard field goal by Andrew Ritter, who will kick away here to start the second half. This is Kendall Sanders from a couple yards deep. And he can only make it out to the 18-yard line. Let's check in with Kaylee Harton.
Joe, Hugh Freeze wants his defense to disguise their pre-snap reads better if they're going to stop this Texas offense. He says if Case McCoy checks, he wants his defense to check. As for his offense, after those quick 14 points they put up on the board, he says they hurt themselves, and this Texas defense has answered the bell.
They sure have, just like a gritty fighter in the late rounds, and that's what they needed, a little bit of fight this week. Manny Diaz was relieved of his duties as defensive coordinator last Sunday. They gave up the 550 rushing yards to BYU, but bouncing back nicely here in this back and forth game. Jonathan Gray going ahead for about 3.5 yards, tackled by Tony Connor.
You know, you can talk about adjusting your defense and all, but if you don't win up front, if you're down four, can't beat their down five, you're going to struggle all night long. And what we saw in the second quarter was Texas down five, whipping the up front of Ole Miss.
Here's a screen to Shipley.
Great rally.
And Shipley gets it just beyond the 26-yard line. It'll be third and short, tackled by Golson.
So if you're Ole Miss, you want to come out in this third quarter, this is right here, this down right now, this will determine whether or not you're successful or not. It's this third down, this conversion.
Shipley's in the slot to the top of your screen. Always a favorite target in spots like this. Third and three. And McCoy looks his way and finds him for a first down out to the 39.
What they did was they took their freshman, Robert Kimdichie, and dropped him in coverage.
First down pass again by McCoy. And once again, it is Shipley finding that pocket out to the 42-yard line. A good start to the second half for Texas.
You forget about Shipley, he will break you as a defense. He is a master at finding holes in zones.
Here's Case again, steps up in the pocket, able to get free for a moment. Smart. And then just burns it as Tony Connor had pressure against Case McCoy. So Case to Jackson after all those years of Colt to Jordan. The little brothers getting it done here now. Of course, the older brothers just a little more combined success as a combination. A
couple hundred, those, no big deal.
For those great Texas teams, over 3,000 yards that Colton Jordan connected on. Shipley, three catches for 36 yards on this drive. They keep it on the ground. Just a minimal gain there to the 40-yard line by Gray.
No pressure. That is the one thing that McCoy has enjoyed here tonight. Same thing that Colt enjoyed all those years. He had good offensive lines. On this third down, Ole Miss has got to generate some pressure. And if they're going to sit in the zone, they got to play it a little tighter. Shipley will kill you on it.
Third and nine. Pick up the pressure. And that should have been intercepted by Cody Pruitt.
Hit him right in the face. Wrong spot. They went man to man. They went man under two deep. And so the ball is usually forced to come high when you have that coverage. Watch how they match everybody up. See, everybody's underneath his man to man. See the two safeties over the top. Well, Pruitt reads it perfectly. That's actually the throw came off high like the coverage hopefully is designed to do. Sets up this fourth.
So Farrah comes on to punt. And he'll look to position this into the corners. Jeff Scott places his heels on the 10-yard line. Angled punt from Farrah. And it bounced at the one and into the end zone. Now Texas was able to move it, but they couldn't convert the third and nine. Beautiful night here atop DKR Texas Memorial Stadium, where the home team's up 23-17, just underway here in the second half in front of the third largest crowd in history, over 101,000 in Austin tonight.
You see, when Ole Miss had success in the first half, they did it on the backs of their pulling linemen, and they did a great job of capturing the edge. Evan Engram did an outstanding job, and then got these big guards out in front, and they were able to pave the way. Now, in addition to the guards getting out there and getting the edge, these receivers down the field did a fantastic job. But it all started up front with the big boys, old Big Duco, 370 pounds of them. And then you follow those receivers, and you got a working running game.
Here's Jeff Scott. Scott lowers that shoulder with a 9-yard run. Ole Miss had two touchdowns in the first 6.5 minutes, but only the field goal since, and that came by way of a penalty just a second ago in the first half. Up tempo now as they get it to Laquan Treadwell.
That's his first catch test.
That is his first catch. The prized recruit who had 11 catches coming in.
Tell you what he's done really, really well tonight. Is blocking. He has blocked exceptionally well, both he and Moncrief on the outside. Both
they are
big
so
bodies.
Big.
Yep.
First down for Ole Miss. And this time they go to Moncrief, and the Rebels have another first down.
It's a nice combination on the top side. See, they that time they took Treadwell and swung him out underneath, faked it to him. Moncrief got behind the defender, who has to suck up.
Read option, and they keep it on the ground for about 3 yards to Jeff Scott.
You know, lost in all this stuff is Logan 85 on the other side. Jamez Logan he's really an outstanding player.
See Jeff Scott's night, the 88 yards on 11 carries. Had that thrilling 75-yard game winner in opening week, a minute to play against Vanderbilt. He is explosive. Here's Treadwell. And you see that long stride of Treadwell. It was a good block that time by his fellow receiver, Dante Moncrief. Number 12, Matt.
Tess, I like the way both these guys work in combination. They will give you fits. You have to pick your poison over there on that side.
No first down for Ole Miss. Bull Wallace wrapped up that time by Jackson Jeffcoat, the senior defensive end.
Jackson Jeffcoat, of course, son of Jim Jeffcoat, the old Dallas Cowboy, coaching now, but you can see his influence on his son. He works his hands really well, just like the old man did.
Empty backfield on second and 10. That complete to Scott, and Scott is wrestled down at the 35-yard line by Carrington Bindham.
Because they go five wides, and they still they present a lot of problems. Scott can run, and the tight end Evan Engram can also run.
Now that roar coming down on third and four from the upper deck. Texas defense looking for another stop. Here's Scott. Cuts to the inside, and he's going to be right on that line to make as Jordan Hicks came up to meet him. First down, Ole Miss.
Jordan Hicks came up. That was a good hit. And Scott, not the biggest guy on the field, about a buck 65. But he's a tough little guy.
Wallace now, and Wallace takes advantage of a block. He went to the outside of Evan Engram, and he had nobody in front of him until he was able to get down to the 23-yard line. And here comes Barry Brunetti, the transfer from West Virginia, who's been used more and more this year with a run package. He's got three rushing touchdowns already this year, and they brought him in early in the first half as well. Second and three.
We got Moncrief up top all alone. Single high safety up here.
They go with a pod diamond formation, and the play clock coming down as Brunetti switches sides with the backs. And this is Wallace who gets free and spins for a first down to the 16-yard line. Jeff Scott on the carry that time.
Tess, the more I watch Jeff Scott, the more I like him. He is tough. He's got phenomenal balance, very quick.
They stay on the ground, and Walton only able to get about a yard as Cedric Reed was able to pursue down the line.
When you go with that cone, that inverted
and diamond,
what you want to call it, diamond and two wide receivers, that forces you almost to go to man-to-man. Because you have to declare your strength, unless you go to the field, you have to declare your strength on movement. Because you have to keep your front defensively balanced.
Second and nine. And look at the room this time for Bo Wallace. Spins his way into the end zone. A 15-yard touchdown run from the athletic quarterback, Bo Wallace. Now, Texas fans saw enough of Taysom Hill at BYU damage them as a running quarterback, and now Wallace tonight. And Ritter looking to break this tie. And the extra point does just that. Bo Wallace capping a 12-play drive. A 15-yard touchdown run as Ole Miss retakes the lead. Viva Debo seems unaffected. It's been that kind of game. Ole Miss jumped out early. Texas showed a little something, some fire, and then Ole Miss, the field goal before halftime, and now the Bo Wallace touchdown run to take the lead here, 24-23 in the third quarter.
Bo Wallace had a nice little nifty piece of running, and he also had a nice bunch of blocks to get him into that second level.
Andrew Ritter just hit the extra point to break this tie, had the 52-yard field goal to kick away to Kendall Sanders as the Longhorns have been changing things up in the kickoff return personnel. And he will take a knee for the touchback. Reminder that after the game, stay tuned for Texas Game Day Final powered by Chevy Silverado. You can also watch live online, your mobile phone, Longhorn Network app, Mo Galindo, Ricky Williams, Ahmad Brooks, David Green. Guys do a great job. I mean, they know this program inside and out, and it's been a thrill to work alongside them this week. Get all the latest on everything going on with Texas. They will wrap up the night with Texas Game Day Final powered by Chevy Silverado. Joe Tessitore and Matt Millen with you on Longhorn Network. Jonathan Gray nowhere to go that time. That Ole Miss front with Sir'Darrius Bryant the first to arrive.
Sir'Darrius Bryant going to have to be a little careful. Now, he made the play, not the tackle. Jumped around a block, and he came on a blitz. You've got to hold your gap, and that time it worked out for him.
McCoy throws it far into the outside of Jackson Shipley.
You know, I got to tell you, Tess, this Texas team, I think tonight has fed off this crowd. When the crowd has gotten into it, they've kind of responded. Right now, it's kind of a dead crowd. They need to get this crowd into this game a little bit. And I don't know which feeds which, whether the play feeds the crowd or the crowd feeds the play.
Interesting times here in Austin. Kind of fork in the road moment for this team and this program. Goes underneath that time, and Mike Davis will be wrestled down at the 29, well short of the line to make, which was the 35, as Mike Hilton came in defensively. So it'll be a three and out as the punt team will come on for the Horns. And Ole Miss, they're the team fired up, feeling a bit of momentum.
Old C.J. Johnson's disappointed. He had himself a sack if he had just kept his feet, but he didn't. But Mike Hilton was able to finish that thing off with a nice tight coverage and tackle.
Big legged Anthony Farrah on. And the dangerous Jeff Scott back to return. This isn't a good punt at all. Did take a Texas bounce though, as they fall on it inside the 20. So it took a good bounce for Texas. Well, Scott came really close to that ball. Ended up being a 52-yard punt for Farrah. Gorgeous night in Austin. Ole Miss up 24-23. Ole Miss. Glad you're with us on Longhorn Network alongside Matt Millen and Kaylee Hartung. I'm Joe Tessitore. Number 25, Ole Miss. Program on the rise in the SEC against a Texas team trying to bounce back after the disappointment at BYU. Jeff Scott. And Scott with just a quick burst and another first down as he was met by Steve Edmond, but a 13-yard run by Scott.
And another nice block outside by Dante Moncrief. He's having himself a good game.
They don't keep it between the tackles much. As Wallace tries to get to the edge and goes for a gain of four. Bo Wallace, who had the 15-yard touchdown run earlier. Here's Scott again. Another gain of three. It'll be second down and three for Ole Miss. Third down and three, excuse me.
Now here comes the crowd.
Greg Robinson's defense being asked for a stop here. Three practices into the job as the new defensive coordinator. Let's see how they respond.
Ooh. On creep on the backer.
That's number 12 in the slot to the top of your screen as the play clock is coming down. Jordan Hicks matched up with Moncrief. Let's see if Wallace notices.
Take it.
Instead, it's a design quarterback run, and Wallace gets it. First down, Rebels.
So he spreads everybody out. You make sure you get your backers outside, and then you do it. So you motion him, and you get him outside, and then it's just one step and get up the field. Good concept.
Here's a screen with Treadwell. And Treadwell taken down short of the 50-yard line. Numbers on Treadwell, three catches tonight. Had nine against Vandy in that thriller to open up the season in SEC play. Wallace, nowhere to go.
Bad read by Wallace. He'd been making some pretty good reads.
Desmond Jackson, defensive tackle, was able to clog things up on the inside, and it's a third and seven.
Here comes the crowd again. They can feel it. They're going to sit in the zone. Two safeties sitting deep.
And Wallace finds a pocket in that zone with Treadwell.
Wow, that's really well done. That was well done by Bo Wallace. He saw it right away. He saw Treadwell had leverage on the defender, and the ball came out quick.
That was Adrian Phillips defending there. 11 yards on third and seven. Up tempo now as they are quick to get to the line. And he keeps it again, and he slides down before Jordan Hicks is able to get to him as he gets to the 35-yard line. Second and five there.
By faking to Jeff Scott, you pull extra defenders out of the middle, and then he replaces back inside. You watch, here comes the fake, and then you can see the defenders, they're going to flow this way. And that opens up on the backside where he takes advantage of that void.
Everybody reading Scott, he's got 116 rushing yards, but it's Wallace keeping there. This time he passes off of it, and he finds Treadwell in the seam there, and it's a big gainer down to the 18-yard line. Good work by Bo Wallace.
And Laquan Treadwell, who lost his shoe and goes off the field.
17-yard reception by the freshman, the true freshman, the number one receiver recruit in the country last signing day. Jeff Scott, just a yard that time. Shiro Davis on the tackle.
Looks like Santos is kind of hobbling off.
Number 55, the linebacker for Greg Robinson's Texas defense. 2 minutes to play here in the third. Ole Miss has come out strong in his second half. Right in stride and right into the end zone is Evan Engram. Boy, oh boy, did Wallace craft something there on that drive.
That's just getting, Evan Engram's just going to get inside the safety. See how the safety starts to widen? He widens, and then you go with the play action, and he jumps right back down the side. See this void? That's where you want to get to. See the play action inside, sucks the backer up. Because the safety's already sitting outside, Engram fills the void, and here comes the ball for six.
And here comes Ole Miss, just like they did to start the game. Bo Wallace, and at offense, finding their top gear. 31-23.
When it's game day, I'm ready to play. I got a long horse to fall on when the sun goes down.
31-23. After Evan Engram hauled in a 17-yard touchdown catch from Bo Wallace and Greg Robinson, new defensive coordinator this week. Well, his defense having some issues here now in the third quarter against this Ole Miss offense.
It's really about numbers in the pass game, Kess. If you're going to play a balanced zone, they're going to beat you with numbers. That was just a flood concept.
A game of scoring runs. Ole Miss scored the first 14 points. Texas answered back at the next 23, and then Ole Miss responding with the next 17 points.
I want to show you something. This is what you call a flood. You're going to keep a high safety. See the safety? He's going to stay over the top. Then you have one, two, three, and here's your fourth receiver, okay? You only have one, two, three defenders to defend them. You have to pull somebody from the inside out. And they didn't with the play action. You have to honor that. So Edmonds, 33, he steps up to honor the run fake, and Engram is back. It's like stealing.
Keenan Robinson and defensive staff, after all the headaches a week ago with Taysom Hill and BYU and the rushing record set against them, now they need to solve this problem against up-tempo Ole Miss. And how about the defense with Mike Hilton coming straight in, hard as can be, against Kendall Sanders?
Yeah, that's a nice read and a good tackle. He sees it right away. It's his eyes back inside, recognize it right away. There are no blockers in front of him. Go make the play.
Play handoff to Bergeron, and he spins for about 3 yards that time before he's tackled by Bryant.
Tess, you know, you and I, we had this team first game of the season.
Against Vandy.
Against Vanderbilt. And it was kind of the same pattern. They came out hot. Then the second quarter, they slowed down. Then the third quarter, they came out and sped up again. And the fourth quarter, they slowed down. And then at the end, they won it.
The inconsistencies of talented youth.
Youth.
And right now, it is in their favor. Third and seven. Case McCoy looking to extend the play. Oh, that was dangerous, but it goes incomplete as he was looking for Sanders, and Cody Pruitt had coverage as McCoy threw back against it, and it'll make for a fourth and seven, just over half minute remaining here in the third quarter.
Great call by you, Tess. That is extremely dangerous, and a lot of times it's feast or famine, because if Pruitt doesn't get his hand on that thing, Sanders might still be running.
Second time Pruitt has had an opportunity there. McCoy gets away with one. Second straight three and out for the Texas offense. Farrah back on to punt away to Jeff Scott. And came after that one a bit. Farrah got a good kickoff as Scott returns. From inside the 30, he made a miss and he's still on his feet. Oh, there was a block there at midfield as Scott picks up a front end of blockers that carry him all the way to the end zone. No flag is down. 73-yard punt return touchdown, Jeff Scott.
They got away with one, Tess.
There was a block at midfield that you could question, but no penalty flag is down.
It looked like Bobby Hill, number 15, came back and got a block that he got away with one. See if we can pick it up here. Right there. There it is. Number 15.
I thought for sure you were going to see a penalty flag. And ooh, that extra point.
That was blocked.
Was blocked. So that'll keep it a 14-point margin. Jeff Scott in the open field, which he created on his own, is so explosive.
He is sudden. Low to the ground. Watch him get through things. Oh, that's a nice job block right there. He makes him miss completely, And now he picks it up. There's the block right there. It was Hill, 15. Looks like he hit him in the back. And that's all that Scott needed.
And then
that's a good block.
All the guys out in front still running down and creating open space for Scott as they paved the way and he delivered.
The more I watch this kid, the more I like him. He is one talented player.
Remember, he had that thrilling 75-yard game-winning touchdown run with just over a minute to play at Vanderbilt. And here a 73-yard punt return for a touchdown to give Ole Miss a 14-point lead.
What a valuable guy to have on your team. You can see the return yards, the receiving yards. He's a threat. Every time he lines up, you have to honor what he can do.
Blocked extra point. Kept it at 14, but that look of concern on the face of Mack Brown. Kendall Sanders from deep in his end zone, and Sanders with a long stride. And he stiff-arms his way out to midfield. So a good return for Texas.
And a nice answer.
-51-yard kickoff return.
That's the end of the third quarter.
For Texas. End of three. Special teams playing a big role now.
You're what?
Thunderbirds, Austin Classic, and Ole Miss was tough enough in that third quarter, outscoring Texas 20-0 in this game of scoring runs. They've scored the last 23 points to take a 37-23 lead to start this fourth quarter. Jonathan Gray, just a yard there. Let's check in with Kaylee.
Joe, this Ole Miss defense certainly feeling like they have momentum on their side. Now, for whatever they may miss without Denzel Kimdichie on the field with him, I'm told they miss just as much on the sidelines. He is a fiery vocal leader of this team. But in his place, DT Shackelford on the sideline saying, guys, we've got them playing our game now. Joe?
Denzel, the older brother of Robert Kimdichie, young defensive lineman, as Texas keeps it on the ground with Jonathan Gray.
So there's one
here
that you
hear the crowd a little bit here with the play calling as it brings up third and long.
Well, they shouldn't be complaining. What they should be complaining about is this offensive line, which in the first half was moving this Ole Miss defense all over the place. Here in the second half, they've had no movement in the deep offensive line at all.
Third down. McCoy trying to get away from a little pressure up the middle that goes incomplete as he was going underneath, and Trey Elston was there to break up that play to Jonathan Gray. So it'll be fourth down for Texas, trailing by two touchdowns.
Now, what they were able to do, Tess, get pressure with four. You ran your, so you were able to have your the double coverage, and they could bump their coverage underneath, which is what they did. They got pressure and he felt it. There was nowhere to go with that ball.
Three straight, three and outs, and Jeff Scott back out there on punt return. See if he gets an opportunity here, which will be an angled kick by Farrah. And takes a good bounce and it's down right about the 1 yard line. That was Leroy Scott on special teams. Remember, Jeff Scott had the 73-yard punt return touchdown. Now, Ole Miss backs against the walls there. We've had plenty of scoring here tonight. Ole Miss scored the first 14 points. Texas roared back. Davis had the screen pass for a touchdown. They scored the next 23 points. They were up at the half, 23-17, but then Ole Miss outscored Texas 20-0 in the third quarter. Bo Wallace had the 15-yard touchdown run. Engram, the freshman, with a touchdown reception, and then the 73-yard punt return for a touchdown by Scott. Now here we are in the fourth quarter with Texas needing to catch a little break, and maybe it's their special teams that has set it up for them, as Ole Miss will start from just beyond their goal line. Not much room for Jeff Scott. You see Jackson, Jeff Coat, and Whaley, and the rest of them on the inside.
Whaley's playing himself a pretty good game inside here in the second half, and I'll tell you who else is playing a good second half. Bo Wallace. Bo Wallace has been 8-for-8 here in the second half test.
Ole Miss junior quarterback needs to get some breathing room here. Second and 10 with the ball on the 1 yard line. Big opportunity for the Texas defense. He's going to pass from his end zone, and he's going to take a shot deep. And it'll make for a third and 10 as he overthrew Dante Moncrief, who was covered by Bindum.
Carrington Bindum did a good job. They went with play action, which means you get extra blockers inside. It was a one receiver route basically on the outside, but Bindum did a nice job on the double move right there. Sets up this third down.
Greg Robinson, we'll see what he dials up here with Ole Miss from the 1 yard line. Third and 10. The pressure off the edge. He sprints to the other side, and that is incomplete as it went right off the hands of Dante Moncrief. So they'll be punting from their own end zone.
Can't have that. That ball needed to be caught. Moncrief had himself a shot, went off his pads. Can't let it get into your body.
Oh, he settled right into that pocket of the zone in front of Josh Turner, but couldn't come up with the catch.
Yeah, Moncrief, he won't miss one like that for the rest of the season.
So Tyler Campbell in that tight formation, just a foot in front of that back line as Diggs is at the 47, set to return. Takes an Ole Miss bounce, fielded at the 49, and then he just scoots out. 12:37 remaining.
Case McCoy has to pick it up, and where he has to pick it up is get the ball back into the hands of Mike Davis. Remember early in the game, Mike Davis was the guy who they were featuring. He was stretching the field on the outside, and then he was also throwing back underneath because they had to really respect his speed. Since that time, we haven't seen much of Mike Davis. He's back on the field.
Major Applewhite upstairs this week. We're going to manage Colt McCoy here in the fourth quarter, who has had some big moments in his career rallying the troops before. Let's see if he can have one now. Bergeron, not much room at all. That was Mike Hilton and Sir Darius Bryant coming up to stop Joe Bergeron.
That was outstanding run support to the outside. Hilton came off a block off of Mike Davis. Really, Sir Darius Bryant and he both put it on him.
Second and 9.
Guess you have a nice cushion up on the top side with Mike Davis. Take advantage of what they're giving you.
This is complete to Sanders, and Sanders will be a couple yards short. He'll be third and short as he was tackled by Sinquez Golson.
Guess you know what? I'm going to scratch that on Mike Davis. I'm watching him run, and he's limping.
Remember,
he's not the
same
guy. He
was affected earlier tonight. Yep. He came off the field, put himself back out there, but clearly not at 100%.
He is not the same guy.
I've been looking Sanders' way just a bit. Third and 2. And we're going to get a timeout here.
It's the first timeout of the half.
Texas will have 2 timeouts remaining. It'll be a third and two. Mike Davis, one of their big playmakers, clearly not at full speed. Short break. We'll be right back for third and two. Stay with us.
Texas football on the Longhorn Network is powered by the all-new 2014 Chevy Silverado. Strong for all the roads ahead.
6th Street here in downtown Austin, the live music capital of the world. You know, Ole Miss had such success on the road week one in the Music City. Up in Nashville, had that thrilling win against Vanderbilt, and now they've had an explosive second half against Texas to take a 37-23 lead. But Texas with good field position off the defensive stop, and now facing a third down and two. Bergeron. Oh, he stumbled in the backfield with all that pressure in the mix that time. Sir Darius Bryant and the rest of them getting in, and it'll be a fourth down for the Longhorns.
So what do you do here, Kess?
Well, you're down two scores here. Fourth quarter, your offense staying on the field with this distance here. 39-yard line.
That is really, that's gross. 90 for Isaac Gross. That is a man play. That's how you get off.
He's the undersized nose tackle that plays bigger than he is. Goes 6'1", 250. Fourth and three now for Mack Brown's team.
Timeout up top. We're going to Ole Miss timeout.
Timeout, Ole Miss. First time out of the half. Be a 30-second timeout.
What Hugh Freeze saw, Tess, was they came out with three receivers to one side, and they're going to bunch. When you see bunch, you have to be able to back off because there's the possibility of picks.
After the game, you can stay tuned for Texas Game Day Final, powered by Chevy Silverado. That's also available online and also on your phone with the Longhorn Network app. That's available free in the Apple App Store. Lowell and Ricky, Ahmad and David will give you everything you need to know in analyzing tonight's action.
This is what they came out with. They went with three receivers up top. When you have that and they get into a bunch package and they start to tighten it up, there's only one way to really defend it. It's one defender outside, one defender inside, and one in the middle. So it's inside, outside, high. But you have to tighten it down really tight. And what it does is it sets you up for being picked.
Fourth and three. Malcolm Brown is the back here.
Jackson Shipley's the guy.
Ace McCoy. He goes to Shipley, diving effort. It is right at the stick.
He was man-to-man with Cody Pruitt.
And it is a first down for Texas.
That was all Shipley. Pruitt was all over him. And then McCoy threw it the only place it could be, down and low. Shipley made a great catch.
Oh, you called that, Miller. Oh, reliable. Jackson Shipley. So they're going to review this, the mark, which Shipley dove for it right at that stick. And the officials just said, move those chains. And now they're going to take a look. Watch Shipley here on the near side. You know, his knee is already down when he catches the ball.
And the ball is behind the line, at least behind our spot.
Now keep in mind that yellow line that you see, that is unofficial. But watch his knee as he catches the ball. It's already down.
Down, and there's the catch.
So anything beyond that, at the moment the catch is corralled and he firmly has it, that's where the spot should be.
100% correct, Tess.
Soon as he establishes firm control of the ball, because he maintains possession throughout, the knee's already down.
Knee's down.
So right there, it's over.
And it appears that that's behind that line.
After review, ruling on the field stands. First down.
So the ruling on the field stands. So there was not the evidence they needed to reverse the call and change that spot. So it is a first down as Texas converted the fourth and three.
It's a heck of a throw by McCoy. Down and low, where only one guy can get it. And Shipley went and got it.
touchdown Texas, much needed. Under 10 and a half minutes to play, trailing by two touchdowns. Play action. Looking for Shipley again. Overthrew him as he was covered by Mike Hilton.
Mike Hilton saw the double move, never bit. Stayed on top of it the whole time. We've seen a lot of double moves here tonight.
Sure have.
They've been trying to take shots all night long. Here's a double move. Didn't even, not a flinch. Stayed on top of it. Good non-call.
McCoy. Oh, that ball came loose. Malcolm Brown ran right into Case McCoy as he was winding up.
That's a fumble. Mike Mary came out.
And Ole Miss has it. Brown stepped forward. McCoy was winding up, and the ball came loose. And Ole Miss jumped right on it.
Watch Brown. He's going to step up right here. And he knocks the ball right out of his hand. Holy smokes, it's the second one we've had of the night. First, you got Ole Miss quarterback dropping it. Then you have the Texas player knocking it out of his own hand. How did Brown not come up with that thing? Mike Mary ends up coming up with it.
So after converting the fourth and three, disaster strikes the Texas offense. And now Ole Miss in prime position. And look at Jeff Scott. What did you say? Sutton?
He is sudden.
Undoubtedly.
You know who he reminds me of?
Who's that?
Dat Thomas.
You know?
He's got that.
I'll tell you.
He's got it.
A few guys that compare to the Oregon star, but this burst on Scott that we see time and time again is something. 32-yard run, and he did it just like that.
Just like that.
149 yards rushing. How about a few more? Untouched until he was about 13 yards downfield before Adrian Phillips met him. As Scott goes for 15 yards.
On the back of Moncrief and Treadwell, the receivers. And then he just ran right past. Hicks wasn't even close, just hit another gear.
Moments ago, it was Texas marching, looking to close this to seven. And now look at Ole Miss down to the 12-yard line. And here's Walton inside the 10. Cedric Reed with the tackle.
This is where Texas, this is what Mack was talking about. Bad things happen to his team, and they just kind of fall apart. Somebody has nothing to do with the coach. That's on your team, man. You got to make that happen. Somebody's got to make a play right now. Man up.
They've been trying to drill that message in all year long, especially this week.
Ain't happening.
Not at all. Jalen Walton from a turnover at one end with a running back going right into McCoy to an instant offense touchdown at the other. Boy, this Texas season is being pushed to the brink here. Early on,
there'll be people sitting at home and is gonna say, man, they look soft. That's been the buzzword around this place.
Mack Brown was quite honest in even addressing that when he met with us. And that extra point was barely in that time by Ritter, who had one block before. 44-23. McCoy was winding up. The next thing you know, it's on the ground. And Walton turned the corner. And Greg Robinson, yeah, these fans know exactly how you feel. Welcome to the Longhorn staff.
Texas, Friday at 7 on Longhorn Network.
Number 25, Ole Miss, is up 44-23 on a Texas team that was talked about as being loaded with experience and talent, but the defensive woes continue. Last week, the total yards against BYU. Tonight, 427 already put forth by Ole Miss, who has 30 unanswered points. They've outscored Texas 27-0 in this second half. Ace McCoy, the fumble moments ago that led to the quick strike score by Ole Miss on the ground. It was Walton bringing it home after Jeff Scott, the running back to his right, brought him right down the field. Both small and fast. Walton 5'8", 166. Scott 5'7", 162. And a perfect fit for what Hugh Freeze likes to do offensively.
Look at
those last 2 weeks.
800 yards.
800 rushing yards allowed in a span of 7 days. Is that incredible? There's still 8:42 to play in this game, Millen.
Holy smokes.
And then you think about the road ahead, because they haven't even gotten the Big 12 play yet. Next week they will start Big 12 play with a K-State team that obviously lost to an FCS squad, but Oklahoma, TCU, Oklahoma State, who looks the part of a title contender, Texas Tech, who just came up with a big win against TCU, and a Baylor team with Art Briles right up the road. Baylor team that can flat out score with anybody in the country.
I think Art Briles is one of the best coaches in the country.
Case McCoy goes to Sanders again. Texas in the second half, Matt, 5 possessions, 4 punts and a fumble. 4 punts and a fumble for your 5 offensive possessions. And that fumble was just brutal. I mean, they were in position. They had converted the fourth down. They were looking to cut this thing down to 7. And Malcolm Brown ran into Case McCoy. Here's McCoy right over the middle, and he's able to get it complete out to midfield to Jackson Shipley.
There's still enough time to get back in this thing. They have to score here. You'll be down by 14. You've got, your defense has to come up with something. This defense has to show up here in the second half at least once. But first things first, they've got to come down here and get a score.
Now remember, they were talking about the mentality looking at the scoreboard against BYU,
right,
and they didn't like the way they responded last week. That ball was almost intercepted. That's the third time tonight Cody Pruitt could have had a pick.
It looks like Shipley just didn't even think the ball was even going to be close to him. He just stopped on it.
Saw some pressure by Thompson there against McCoy. The end of the play with Pruitt. He did. He turned and looked.
Yeah, that shouldn't happen.
Second and 10. They only bring 3 as he's able to once again look Sanders' way.
Ole Miss is just playing him sitting in his zone. 2 safeties back deep, letting everything throw underneath. They're content to do that. Rushing 3.
And Gray only able to get about a yard.
Looks
as
like a
flag is down. And he just got to the line of scrimmage, but that was Isaac Gross who cut him down.
Isaac Gross, man, he gets off the ball. They haven't had an answer for him a few times here in the second half.
And he's a guy that was slowed by injuries and really struggled to get
holding
up to speed.
Offense 66. 10-yard penalty from previous spot. He's turned out.
And that's the guy who was blocking Isaac Gross.
Yep, Flowers
Cedric
on Gross.
Flowers.
Isn't it amazing how Ole Miss has gone in a span of just about a year and a half of a team that was trying to find itself, bringing a new coaching staff, to a team that is really on the rise. Here they come, squads in the SEC. And now Gray unable to keep his footing there at the 47-yard line.
3 players on that offense. Boy, that Tunsil, and you see Connor is another one they brought in. Kim Dicci is another one on the defensive side. But Tunsil, the left tackle, Laquan Treadwell, and Evan Engram, 17, the tight end. they have made a huge difference on this offense.
Well, listen, there are recruiting classes. This is a 4th and 7 coming up. There are recruiting classes, and there's the biggest catch of all in Robert Condici, number one recruit in the country last year. There are recruiting classes ranked ahead of them on signing day. But in terms of what you're seeing on the field, this is as productive of a group early on in their career as I've ever seen. I mean, instantly making a huge impact and improving a program entirely.
And the guy who was the centerpiece of the class, he's probably the rawest of the group. he's got further to go. Now, it's a tougher position to play given what he's going against inside, but there's some real talent out there.
Here's 4th and 7. McCoy slings it to the near side and unable to come up with it that time as he was looking for Davis. So 6:19 remaining. Ole Miss, a 3-touchdown lead, looking to close this thing out, move their mark to 3-0. This year in this second half, 44-23. Tavius Mathers tracked down in the backfield that time. Malcolm Brown got to him. The play of the game is powered by the all-new 2014 Chevy Silverado. How about Jeff Scott with a 73-yard punt return for a touchdown?
Yeah, and how about how many missed tackles were on that thing? There were 7 missed tackles. There were 7 guys who had an opportunity to stop him before he crossed the goal line. Now, having said that, that is one talented guy.
243 all-purpose yards. That's a career high for Jeff Scott. Has the 2 touchdowns, 164 rushing yards. He is a dynamic playmaker for the upstarts in the SEC, Ole Miss. And here's Jalen Walton, who almost a carbon copy of everything Scott is. Same size, same kind of speed, same kind of style. And that was a good run to make for a 3rd and 1.
If we had to pick a guy tonight who is the difference maker in the whole game, it would be Jeff Scott.
As it was in the season opener against Vanderbilt.
Correct.
When he had the game-winning touchdown, a 75-yard game-winning touchdown with just over a minute to play. That, according to the research I heard, was the longest game-winning touchdown at that time in a game in the last 10 years of college football.
Is that right?
To take the lead and win a game. And that's going to be a 1st down with Tavius Mathers, the Nashville native, running the ball inside the 40. So now you look at the Ole Miss schedule and you think, and I remember having a conversation with Hugh Freeze this spring, and he said, Joe, we could be a better team and not have a good record in the first 7 games. Well, they've made it through Vandy. They're going to make it through Texas, and look who's sitting out there in the coming weeks.
You got it.
Sitting out there. Number 1, Alabama, Johnny Football. And then home against Les Miles and the Tigers. 3 biggies, and you know what? You better bring your A game to play this young, confident team.
They're getting better each week, and they're getting more confident. And a confident team is it? Oh, that looked like it hurt.
Now, Bo Wallace on that knee brace.
That did hurt.
You know, it kind of grabbed the turf there, and it hit the brake a little faster than I think he thought it was going to be.
He's walking on it all right, though.
He's walking fine. There's no point for him to be out there under these circumstances.
Looks like the brace may have caught it.
Yeah, the brace was bent out to the side. Watch the side of that brace, and you see it shifts out to the outside of his knee. So the equipment guys are going to get the wrench and the pliers out and start dealing with that. And Barry Brunetti will come in, and Walton will take this carry. On 2nd down. And
second half test. Tale of 2 games. The second half, what do they have? 250 yards of total offense to maybe, I don't know, maybe 100?
I mean, it's before this drive, it was 220 to 95.
Oh, here you are. 237.
Greg Robinson, 3 practices in to the new job as defensive coordinator after Manny Diaz was relieved of his duties after BYU ran through them for 550 rushing yards. Third down and eight.
Oh, nice.
And Mathers, look at the moves as Mathers was able to snake his way close to a first down as he's down at about the 29-yard line. As Greg Robinson pregame, as he was amped up, his return as defensive coordinator, he went from the white shirt to the black shirt.
You know why that is? Because he gives signals in the sideline. And you want a darker shirt so you can pick them out with all the other white or orange shirts that are on the sideline. He'll stand out.
Well, Mac Brown is out there in the white shirt. Mac Brown's going to have more questions coming his way tonight and this
time
week about the state of this program and where things are for Texas. And of course, after the game, you can stay tuned for Texas Game Day Final powered by Chevy Silverado. You can also get that on the Longhorn Network app. And that will be one of the questions. It was one of the questions this week. And Mac said, listen, when there's something broken, you fix it right away. And now a lot of folks talking about where this program is currently. Obviously, 2009, they played for it all. And then results just haven't been there in recent years.
Yeah, and if you listen to the pregame show this morning on game day on ESPN, you had a couple different opinions. And so you heard Lee Corso talk about, you know, it's not the coach's fault. And you heard the players say it is the coach's fault. And I got to be frank with you. To me, it's always a combination. It's never just one thing. If it's one thing, you fix that thing. But it's more than that. And I put a lot of it on the players. Look, you get a plan from a coaching staff, and then you have to go and execute it. That's it. It's on you. Now, these are young kids, and they're still, you know, some of them are learning, but you got some guys who have had a lot of experience. And there's no excuse for not performing at a high level. If you have the skill set to do it, that's what you should be doing.
Some contemplation and reflection on that Texas sideline. So many five stars and top-notch athletes in this program, and yet the results in recent years just not falling in line with the talent. Remember, after 09, that team went 5-7 and then 8-5 in that Holiday Bowl and the Alamo Bowl over Oregon State last year on a 9-win team. And they thought maybe, okay, David Ash seeing the light and things are going well and the offense early this year, big strike capability. But then there against BYU, defense started to falter. Here tonight against Ole Miss, it went south again. And the crowd.
That's the telltale sign right there, Tess, what you're watching. When they lose interest, you got a problem.
An unranked Texas team against ranked opponents here in Austin under Mac Brown. Got to go back to 1998. Texas A&M find a win. Texas 1-2 for a start to the season, a 1-2 record. Only once under Mac Brown. That was all the way back in 98, his first season. These are just different times.
On the other side, Bo Walls played himself an outstanding second half, really played himself an outstanding game. There are a lot of guys on that sideline who can have their chests out tonight.
Rometty's just going to toss this away here on 4th and 6. Hugh Freeze, forget the rebuilding job. This is now a contending job, right? Second year at Ole Miss, 7-6 last year. Remember, he was part of the Ole Miss coaching staff back in the mid-2000s. He was the recruiting coordinator. And he came back here, follow up what Houston Nutt had done, got them on the right track. They were a team that was clearly improving the second half of last season, as that goes incomplete. It was almost picked off with that diving effort. And now here's Hugh Freeze. with an Ole Miss team with all the recruiting momentum and already getting results on the field with road wins are tough places. A much improved Vanderbilt program and coming down here against a Texas team that came to play with purpose, a Texas team that
had a chip on its shoulder
and wanted to prove itself and bounce back.
Oh man,
and a little
nice
bit of a
read
statement there here in the final 2 minutes by Mike Hilton.
Hilton's played himself a good game tonight too. He struggled a little bit in the second quarter and then he regrouped. I'll tell you, this whole team did. This whole team, after halftime, this was a different team. The quarterback played extremely well. Scott played his usual outstanding game. It's just it's a fun team to watch, to be honest with you. Got a lot of talent on the outside. That receiving core that they put together down there is, they're pretty darn good.
Here's Mike Davis, third and 12. Take a seat there at the 39-yard line. Now the freshmen, we've talked about them all night long. Condici had three tackles, a tackle for loss. Treadwell, not the biggest receiving night, but you know, he played a role here tonight. He was blocking well.
Oh my goodness.
And
yeah.
Evan Ingram had the touchdown, had the 44 receiving yards. This group, and this core group of young talent, watches the weeks go on. It's a fourth and 5 here for Texas. McCoy almost tripped up, keeps the play alive, and that ball was batted. So a
Kandici got
loss on downs there as Robert Kandici batted away. Second loss on downs on the 7 possessions, second half. 4 punts, a fumble, 2 times a turnover on downs. And how about Ole Miss coming on the road to move their mark to 3-0?
That's a big win for the Fighting Archie Mannings.
Old number 18, the speed limit on campus back in Oxford to honor Archie Manning, one of the all-time greats. I think they're going to be enjoying things back in the Grove this week. The premier tailgating spot in all of college football. They may be having one or two to celebrate a road win and 3-0, the first time Ole Miss has been 3-0 since 1989. And their first win against Texas since the 1958 Sugar Bowl. 30 unanswered points by Ole Miss. As Mack Brown will once again have to assess things and ask the question, where are we and where are we going? 1-2. Starting the season 1-2. Last time they did that, his first season back in 98. From high hopes and a preseason ranking to back-to-back losses and a defense giving up a lot of yards. Ole Miss had 449 total yards tonight. Special teams gave way with a 73-yard punt return touchdown by Jeff Scott for the Rebels. And Texas, without their starting quarterback, their blazing fast offensive weapon in DeJay Johnson, and a less than 100% Mike Davis, their other capable receiver. They drop it here at home to the Rebs.
Nice scene over there with that sea of red. Those Rebel fans who came down.
Remember, Texas game day post game report is coming up next. For Matt and Kaylee, I'm Joe Tessitore. 44-23 your final, Ole Miss.